Kia ora, nga mihi nui ki koutou katoa. He mihi atu ki ngā tangata o Parihake I tēnei rā. No tohu roa ko te whiti, te raukura o te maunga rongo. I want to acknowledge today is the 140th anniversary of the invasion of Parihake, and I mihi to the mana of the people of Parihake and the legacy of peaceful resistance that you have been a part of. I'll now hand over to Dr. Caroline McElnay for an update on the latest case numbers. I'll make a few comments on economic supports after that, and then we'll take your questions. Dr. McElnay.
Thank you, Deputy Prime Minister, and kia ora koutou katoa. There are 163 new COVID-19 cases in the community to report today. Of these, 159 are in Auckland and 4 are in Waikato. These new cases take our total cases in this outbreak to more than 4,000, now sitting at 4,034, of which 1,723 have now recovered. There are also 4 new cases in managed isolation, 2 new cases and 2 historical cases. Further details are in our statement. Today we are also sadly reporting a second death in the community of a person who was isolating at home with COVID-19. The Ministry's condolences are with this person's whānau at this sad time. St John's attended a call this morning for an emergency call to an address in the suburb of Mount Eden and found the person deceased on arrival. The man is understood to have been recently treated in hospital. Health authorities in Auckland are working with the police and ambulance to review the circumstances around the death. Both deaths reported this week are being investigated as part of a wider joint systemic review in collaboration between Ministry of Health and the Auckland District Health Boards about the home isolation of COVID-19 patients in order to identify any improvements that may be needed to the system. And both deaths will be examined through the coronial process. On hospitalisations, there are 69 people in hospital with COVID-19. All except one are in Auckland, and the other person is in Waikato Hospital. 6 of these patients are in ICU or a high dependency ward. On testing, there were 28,890 tests processed across the Motu yesterday. And thank you to everyone who came forward to be tested. Remember, if you have any symptoms that could be COVID, please get tested wherever you are in the country. All DHBs are ensuring there is good access to testing across the regions. And labs do prioritise the testing of close contacts, those who are symptomatic, or those who have been at locations of interest. Our labs are working at pace to process tests as quickly as possible, and the majority of our results are returned within 24 hours. We do understand the pressure that's put on individuals and families if there is a delay in receiving the result of the test, and we thank you for your patience. The advice for patients awaiting test results remains the same: stay home until you get a negative result. Just back to Auckland, given the number of new and active community cases of COVID-19 in Auckland, our approach has shifted from listing every location of interest to focusing on high-risk events. These are exposures where there are likely to be close contacts of a positive case. Low-risk exposure events such as drive-throughs or supermarkets are no longer being reported as locations of interest in Auckland because the public health risk is very low. We will continue to publish higher risk close contact exposure events in public spaces when they occur, such as gyms or indoor recreation centres or movie theatres. That's clearly not the case in Auckland at the moment. And we're also looking at providing a much better improved map function so that it's easier to see hotspots in specific areas. We will continue to publish casual exposure events in other parts of New Zealand because there are currently much fewer of those. And it's important that anyone, regardless where you are in the country, continue to keep a record of where you've been, use the Tracer app, and that really does help us to fast track our ability to contact, trace, and respond to those situations. Just an update on Northland. We are continuing to encourage people who live in or around Taipa Kangaroa, Awanui and Kaitaia to get tested if they have had symptoms of COVID-19 in the last couple of weeks. There are 10 community testing centres and 9 vaccination clinics available across the region today. Locations for both of those can be found on Northland District Health Board's website. And there were over 1,000 tests taken across Northland yesterday and 1,285 vaccinations given, including 378 first doses. Just an update on Waikato. There are four, as I said earlier, there are 4 new cases confirmed in the Waikato overnight, 1 each in Hamilton, Te Awamutu, Ngāruia Wahia, and Te Kuiti. 3 new cases are linked to other known cases. There's 1 case in Te Awamutu that is still being investigated by public health. And again, we urge anyone in the Waikato with COVID-19 symptoms, no matter how mild, to please get tested, even if you are vaccinated. 1 patient remains in Waikato Hospital in a stable condition. And just on the testing in Waikato, there were 3,351 tests processed yesterday and 2,958 vaccinations delivered. Just an update on Taranaki. Last night, the ministry was notified of a wastewater detection in Stratford in Taranaki. Public health officials have not yet linked that detection to a known active case in Taranaki. So we're asking anyone in Taranaki with symptoms that could be COVID to get tested. Testing and vaccination sites are available on the DHB website, the Taranaki DHB website. Testing is really important to help us determine whether there's any undetected cases in that community. The vaccination rates are 85% for first doses and 68% for second doses. So the wastewater result is a reminder that if you haven't yet been vaccinated in Taranaki, get vaccinated. And finally, I'd like to encourage everyone who received their first vaccination 3 weeks ago on Super Saturday, October the 16th, to get their second dose this weekend or as soon as possible after that. Everyone vaccinated for the first time during Super Saturday will be getting email and text reminders to get their second shot. So please go and get one to protect yourself, your friends, and your whānau. People in Auckland can also head to Eden Park, which will be open for vaccinations over the weekend. And we're calling on anyone else over the age of 12 who hasn't yet been vaccinated to get their shot. There are hundreds of clinics open all over New Zealand this weekend, including drive-through and walk-in options. It's never been easier. Back to you, Deputy Prime Minister.
Thank you very much, Dr. McElnay. And I want to add my condolences to the friends and family of the person who has passed away. I thought it might be timely to recap on the economic supports that have been provided since the Delta outbreak began, as I haven't been up here for a little while. Since the outbreak began on the 17th of August, we have paid out $5.3 billion in economic support via the wage subsidy and the resurgence support payment. We are now into the 6th round of the wage subsidy since August, and as of this morning, 993,733 applications have been approved, with $3.9 billion paid out. So far, 1,106,686 employees have received the wage subsidy, and 331,153 businesses have been supported with one or more of the wage subsidy payments. The 7th round of the wage subsidy will open next Friday, November the 12th. Also opening on that day is the first double payment of the resurgence support payment. This will be the payment that will be at a rate of $3,000 per business and $800 per FTE, up to a maximum of $43,000. As at yesterday, we had paid out $1.357 billion through the RSP, covering 471,566 applications. I want to recognise that this is a tough time for many businesses and workers, especially those in Auckland, and I want to recognise the sacrifices that have been made. I am proud of the economic support that we have provided and the role that it has played in ensuring that people stay in work and connected with their jobs, as we have seen with the unemployment numbers that came out this quarter. Our actions to support the economy during the pandemic have supported people to stay in work, and we will continue to support businesses. Questions?
When was the last time that health officials had contact with both of those cases that have died in the community?
So my understanding on the one that's been spoken about today is that this is the information I have, and it is subject to confirmation, so I want to be as transparent as I can be, but I do want to say that we're still gathering the information together as we speak to you. My understanding is that this particular person was admitted to hospital on the 1st of November, and they discharged themselves from hospital on the 3rd, that was Wednesday of this week, and that there was phone contact with them on both the 3rd and the 4th of November. And then, as Dr. McElnay has indicated, there was an ambulance called this morning on the 5th. In terms of the first case, I don't have that level of detailed information, other than I know that there was contacts being made through the period, but I don't have the specific details that you're asking.
I'm confident that enough contact is being made with those cases in the community. And also, why is it the positive cases are being allowed by public health to isolate in overcrowded homes? And exactly how many doctors are currently involved in monitoring cases in homes?
I'll begin answering that, and I'm happy to hand over to Dr. McElnay. I am confident in the system. Obviously, when we introduce a new system like self-isolation, we have to continually monitor it, and that's happening. And as Dr. McElnay indicated in her earlier comments, between the Ministry of Health and Auckland Regional Public Health, they're looking at both these specific incidents, but also at the wider system. It's important to note there are still inquiries going on about cause of death at the moment, and I think we've just got to all make sure we allow that to occur. There are always specific circumstances here, and I don't want to immediately assume what the cause of death is for a person. In terms of the second part of your question, the process that we have been informed about by health officials is that there are two assessments done when a person, to decide whether a person will be in self-isolation or whether they will transfer to a facility. The first of those assessments is a public health assessment, and that is an assessment about issues like the suitability of the circumstances where someone is living. Is it a place where they can easily self-isolate? Can they support and look after themselves in that environment? And then the second assessment is a medical assessment. Now, that is undertaken either with a person's GP or with another medical officer. And so those two assessments are made to decide whether somebody should be staying where they are in the facility that they're in.
That's died in an overcrowded home. Are those assessments up to scratch?
As I say, that's the assessment process that we go through. That is being looked at. I'm not going to make a judgment on that. The particular circumstances there. The block that the person stayed in has a mixture of different types of housing within it, but these are the issues that need to be looked into. Mm-hmm. But what I'm telling you is that public health assessment is a critical element of the decision that is made by the local health authorities as to whether somebody should stay there.
Could you answer that other part of that question, please, of how many doctors are currently involved in the monitoring of cases in isolation?
I don't know the actual number of doctors who are involved, but just to reiterate what Deputy Prime Minister says, it's a joint assessment with both a public health assessment as well as a clinical assessment, which looks at the fact that this is somebody who has COVID, so their health needs, and then that's the ongoing monitoring that's put in place as a bespoke arrangement for those individuals and their circumstances, which also takes into account not just their health needs, but their welfare needs.
We'll go to Benedict and then Barry.
Do they have oximeters?
Yes, everyone gets issued with those, yes.
So they can tell if, or they should be able to tell if they're declining in care.
That's right.
How does that work? What's the plan? Is there a certain point where they're told to contact?
Yeah, they're given a briefing and an advice around how to use those oximeters. Again, I just want to stress, we're still at a point here where the cause of death is not necessarily being confirmed. And we're having a discussion about COVID symptoms and so on, and that's understandable because these people have been diagnosed as having COVID. But I just want to caution that we're not in a position at the moment to be able to say what the cause of death was for either patient.
Are you thinking there's perhaps other technology you could get out to help monitor them at this stage?
Well, again, we are going through the process of continuously improving how this works, and the Ministry of Health and the local health authorities will do that, but access to the technology around oximeters is available to everybody.
No, exactly. And of course, this is where, like all of these situations, it's continuous quality improvement. It's very sad, these particular situations, and we will learn from any findings for those two situations, but also with all the others who are being managed at home, that feedback that we get, that the health authorities in Auckland get, and, you know, how to make sure that we're providing the best care for people who are being cared for at home.
Can I ask about Auckland specifically, that there have been confusing signals or statements from the government this week. The Prime Minister saying there'll be a hard border at Christmas, Chris Hipkins saying that cars might have to have a time allotted slot to leave the city at Christmas, and you indicating that the border could be lifted. What is the right statement?
So on the 22nd of October, when we were all in the Banquet Hall of Parliament, Jenna asked a question about whether or not there would be an ability for people to leave Auckland at Christmas time. And the Prime Minister said then that the first and best way of making that happen was to make sure that we had people vaccinated at the 90% level that would allow the framework to take place. We indicated then that we would be reviewing that framework on the 29th of November to see how much progress we had made and whether or not there was anything that we would tweak about that. In the meantime, as was talked about on the 22nd of October, we've been looking at what would we need to do should the border still be in place, because we want Aucklanders to be able to travel around at Christmas time. As we said that day, and I've answered questions about in between times, we've been looking at what processes would be in place for that. For example, the use of vaccine certificates or testing as a way of making sure that when people do move, that's safe. That is the work program that's underway. Nothing's changed about that at all. And we are looking at options. In fairness to Minister Hipkins, he did say that no decisions had been made. They haven't been. We're working on those because we do want to make sure that Aucklanders can travel at Christmas time.
Have you given assurance that Aucklanders will be able to leave the city at Christmas?
That is the commitment that we've given, and we're now doing everything we can to make sure that happens. The first and best way of that happening is for everybody to get vaccinated so that the framework can be put in fully in place, at which point interregional travel is fine. But we're doing exactly what you'd expect us to do, which is contingency planning if that doesn't happen, and making sure that we do have systems in place. You'll also appreciate it's a massive logistical exercise we're talking about here. Tens of thousands of people are likely to want to leave Auckland or come into Auckland during that period of time. And so it's a big job. We're working through the options on it. And as soon as we've made decisions, if they are required to be implemented, then we'll announce them.
Will you require them to be tested? And if so, physically, how will that be able to be achieved?
Well, that's one of the decisions to be made. Certainly the role of vaccine certificates will be important here. And if we choose to put testing on top of that, then that will be achieved by people going to them.
Looking at the moment?
We're working through that, whether or not both vaccine certificates and testing is needed. If testing is needed, we have many, many sites for testing. And during the period of time where we've had people travelling, such as during the quarantine-free travel period, plenty of people have organised themselves to get a test in advance of the time at which that they need to travel. If that is needed, we're still working our way through that.
You said you've made a commitment to Aucklanders that they will be allowed to travel, but can you make a promise to Aucklanders that they can travel wherever they want in the country?
That's what we're working towards. That's the commitment that we've made. That's the commitment that we've made. But obviously, in order to get there, we need to either have ourselves in a position where the framework's operating and we're satisfied that it can operate. That's what the 29 November check-in's about. This work is to make sure that we find another way of being able to achieve that if that can't happen.
Can you rule out those allocated time slots?
Well, that's, as I've said, I don't think that's a particularly practical way of doing it. And in fairness to Minister Hipkins, he was at pains to point out that a decision had not been made to do that. As I said, I don't see it as a particularly practical option, but the ruling and ruling out is kind of how we got here, isn't it? So let's actually take the time now to do the work and make sure that we understand the best way to manage that should we need to. I don't see that as a practical way of doing it. Henry.
Sorry. Is there any real hope around a cabinet table of actually getting to 90% before Christmas across every DHB? No, even if you held the current projections, you're looking at late January, you know, the current rate, and there's no indication that the current rate won't drop further as it has for the last 3 weeks consecutively. So is there any real point keeping the hope alive, or should
I will continue to keep hope alive around the way in which vaccination rates have increased. And while I accept that on straight line projections there are DHBs that at this stage aren't projected to make it by Christmas, I'd also note that as of today, every single DHB in the country has 80% first doses. We are making good progress. But yeah, that's why we built in the 29 November check-in, was so that we could take a look at where we'd got to and see what we might need to do to tweak the system in terms of how the framework operates.
With all sports, consultations underway for how your other portfolio, how vaccine certificates will work and support. Who are you consulting with that? And will they be mandated for both community and elite level sport?
So that's the exercise that's underway now in Sport New Zealand. The Crown entity that manages sport is managing that process. They've got a number of different stakeholders that they're working with, and they then in turn are working with the team at DPMC and others about how a vaccine certificate regime would work. Clearly, there is different, sports have very different needs here. So when you're talking about a major level sport, you know, be it the All Blacks or the Silver Ferns, they're going to have big venues and crowds where it'll be fairly obvious how they might use a vaccine certificate regime. When you get to your local bowling club and how they use it, it is a different matter. And so that's the piece of work that's going through right now.
Update on Taranaki.
There was the Dr. McElnay just gave the update.
There's absolutely no indication right now that we'll worry about.
We don't know. We're not aware of any known cases in the area. The wastewater testing can mean that there's a recovered case who's still discharging virus maybe in the community. But what we do need to do is increase the testing there to see if there are any unknown cases, and that's the call that we're making. And of course, it's also a good reminder to get vaccinated.
Sorry, we'll go to Bernard and then come across.
Minister, is the government thinking of, instead of cordoning off Auckland to stop people getting out who are unvaccinated, instead cordon off the vulnerable areas like Tairawhiti or parts of Northland to stop people getting in? Because you'll have much lower volumes and it would be easier and achieve the same thing.
As I said earlier, the speculation on different things we might be considering is kind of what's happened this week, so I'm going to resist doing that. But you have given an example of another way of managing demand. Yeah, we'll come over here actually and then come back.
Has the ministry released the data to
whānau ora yet? I'm not actually aware of where that's up to. I'm aware that there was further discussion within the ministry. I'm not honestly aware if they've released the data yet.
And Minister, there's 73 Waitara staff heading north this weekend with vax clinics and whatnot. Is that just another example of a failed Māori vaccine rolled out and Māori have to pick up the pieces and clean it up?
Well, as you know, one of the things we've done in the last few weeks is provide further support to a range of different Māori health providers directly to be able to go out and do the vaccination program. So I congratulate any provider who's on the ground making this happen. And right around the country, we are supporting people through government funding direct to NGOs. Some NGOs will also be doing it themselves. We have a funding relationship with Waipareta, so I'm not sure whether this is from that or from other sources that they have. But to me, this is an example of Māori health providers stepping up, and we're here to support them do that.
The reality is, though, for people in, say, Pangaru, they have 2 hours every 3 weeks for a vaccination. That's how much time they're afforded to go and get a vaccination, 2 hours every 3 weeks. And now there's a crew of people going from Auckland to that area to try and boost those numbers. Why wasn't that sorted out earlier? And why has the access been so little for those communities?
Yeah, look, and we've, right from the beginning of this, we've had a focus on making sure that we do get access for people in remote communities. I can't answer the specific question why that district health board has the arrangements that they have that you've described. What I do know is that we have significantly increased the resources that we've given, but Māori health providers have been out there doing this, and I've had questions actually up here about people who've gone into far-flung bits around the Hokianga and elsewhere, which has been really, really great. The government is supporting people to do that in terms of specific decisions that DHBs have made about the timing of when they give vaccinations. I'm just not in a position to comment on that. Come down the front.
Doctor, can we have an up-to-date number on the number of people that are isolating at home? Because on the Ministry of Health's website, there's about 1,200 people that are under the other category, and RNZ hasn't been able to clarify this with the Ministry of Health. So as of today, how many people are isolating at home?
I think with COVID cases, it's about 767
cases.
I suspect some of the issue there is around the other people who are might be isolating with a person, because there are a variety of reasons why they may need to isolate with others who are immediately in their whānau or their family circle. So I suspect that might be where some of the differences in numbers, cases as opposed to people.
Well, there's quite a large proportion of that number, about 1,200, in an other category. So are those people that just haven't, they're either isolating with others with COVID or...
I think it is a data-related issue in the sense that there it'll be a database system and those people won't have yet been allocated. Is that your understanding?
My understanding is that there is a timing and a data issue. But we are seeking clarity because it is important to have the numbers accurate. And as Deputy Prime Minister mentions, there are a number of individuals who will also be isolating at home because they're contacts, not because they're cases. And but some of it, I've been informed, is about a timing issue to do with the data and the updating of what's on the website. We'll get back to you later on this afternoon to at least be able to say when it's clarified.
We'll just do a little round down the front and then up back through to you, Jason.
Just regarding moving to that new framework, Māori Development Minister Roy Jackson said this week he doesn't believe Māori full vaccination rate gets 90% this year, and other people are saying not until March next year. Is the government comfortable moving to that new framework when Māori have reached that 90% rate?
So the reason that we chose 90% in each DHB was to make sure that we had a much better geographical spread, but also a spread in terms of different population groups, including Māori. And so that's the reason we chose that as a 90% DHB proxy. On 90% for the Māori population, that will again vary from DHB to DHB, but it's the reason why we've committed significant additional resources, $120 million, to lift those rates, but also to engage in a longer-term relationship with those Māori health providers to be able to meet those needs. So we've chosen what we believe is a benchmark that has equity inside it, as well as other issues to do with geographical spread. We're just going to hear in there.
So just back to the death, was it Healthline that was calling them? And can you confirm if it was a nurse who was calling them and whether they had access to the deceased person's medical?
This is the second one. I can't confirm. Healthline is obviously one of the people, and all the people who work on Healthline are trained health professionals who are making those calls. I can't confirm if it was. There is other health providers who are also used, so we'd have to go back and check on that for you.
Minister Rock?
Can you confirm if they have access to medical records?
I beg your pardon?
Can you just confirm if they have access to people's medical records in home isolation?
I'll confirm that, but I would have said yes, they would have. Because that's part of being able to put together a management plan for the individual, so you would need access to health
one thing
records,
I would,
but we'll confirm
that would be my expectation too. One thing I would say, just to, if you think about the timeline that I gave you at the beginning, this is a person who discharged themselves from hospital on Wednesday and then was called on Wednesday and Thursday. And obviously, in terms of medical records and so on, catching up with the person, you could imagine that might take a little bit of time, but as far as I'm aware, as Dr. McElnay says, that would be part of the system. Sorry, Gary, we've just got Jason. No. He's had a go.
No,
you go now.
No, I don't mind. I'll take it up. Minister Robertson,
got to step up,
Murray
Jason.
Bolton today, he successfully challenged the government on MIQ, and you're talking about home isolation, 767 COVID cases isolating at home. How long is it before New Zealanders who are itching to get home from overseas, double jabbed and negative tested, how long will it be before they can isolate at home?
So we've indicated that self-isolation will become much more the dominant form of people's just halfway through a sentence, Barry. And so we've indicated that that'll be early in the new year, in the first quarter of next year. That's the process we outlined when we did the reconnecting strategy in August, and that's what we continue to work through. I would note that Mr. Bolton's circumstances are quite specific to him. Not every New Zealander can travel in the way in which Mr. Bolton is. His case has now been reassessed by the Medical Officer of Health, and he's been granted the right to self-isolate. That process exists and people can apply into it. We've also previously talked about the fact that we do still have cases coming in to manage isolation. We actually had 7, I think, yesterday, and maybe about 4 today. So there are still cases there, and not every single one of those people's just stopping in Auckland. They want to go on to other parts of New Zealand. We still continue to have other parts of New Zealand COVID-free. So I appreciate the fact that there is a great desire of people to be able to come back to New Zealand. We're facilitating that as best we can, but we're going to continue to move carefully and cautiously in this area.
Can you explain why it can't be sooner rather than next year?
Well, because we continue to work through how to make self-isolation work well. We've got a self-isolation pilot underway at the moment. We've obviously got the work that we're doing with the community cases who are here. And while we have an outbreak of the nature that we have, and while we have New Zealand with other parts of New Zealand that are COVID-free, we're going to continue to move carefully and cautiously, but self-isolation will absolutely be the way that this is done for many people.
In the last couple of days, we've seen the likes of Joe Rogan and Alex Jones really take, really level in on New Zealand, spouting various different conspiracy theories and things like that. How worried is the government that this sort of far-right, this sort of commentary is going to prevent the last 10% of people getting over the line with the COVID vaccines?
Well, misinformation about COVID-19 is spread by many different sources. And what we know is that for a large percentage of the people who are yet to be vaccinated, it is still simply hesitancy. It's a good conversation with someone they trust that will get them over the line to be vaccinated, or something happening in their lives that causes them to see that. For a smaller minority of people who hold anti-vax views, which sounds like the kind of people that you're talking about, those people, unfortunately, it will be much harder to reach, but our targets at this stage don't require us to turn those people around. In terms of how worried I am about the views of extreme right-wingers, I'm generally worried about those in the world, but specifically right now, I'm just focused on supporting what people to be vaccinated.
Ahead of the Prime Minister's trip to Auckland, is there a security risk that that you're looking into, given that we've seen in a number of places that she's been an increased level of protest? Are you expecting to see that when she goes to Auckland?
I'm sure you won't be surprised that I don't comment on the Prime Minister's security, largely because I don't know very much about it. But what I would say is the Prime Minister always has security with her before COVID and now as well.
The risk assessment tool used to assess whether someone can get out of MIQ early to visit a dying loved one was only updated at the end of October. Why did it take so long for that risk assessment tool to be updated?
That was a tool that was put in place last year and has been used. And it's been used well throughout, and it was updated last week because of signals that have been given around the shortening of the MIQ stay going forward, and so that was an appropriate time to then change the tool. Prior to that, there really had been no significant changes to the way in which MIQ was being operationalised here in New Zealand.
767 actual COVID cases now isolating at home. That tool still makes it nearly impossible for someone to get out of MIQ early. What's the thought process there?
I think that the updated tool, one of the key changes is it does take account of vaccination, and that is definitely something that now we've got as a both protection for our community, but also recognising the impact of vaccination. So that is one of the changes and a shortened period. And we expect that tool to be reviewed. And as we go forward and as we see whatever changes may happen with our MIQ, that exemption process then allows us to get that balance between safety for our community as well as enabling people with genuine reasons for seeking an exemption for that to be supported.
We're just going to head over back to Māori TV.
Doctor, can you tell us what ethnicity those two people who we sadly lost, what ethnicity they were?
I'm sorry, I don't have that information.
Further to that, could you tell us how many Māori have been hospitalised? How many are in ICU or HDU? And how many of today's cases are Māori?
I can start on that. So in terms of today's cases, 35% are Māori, 28% Pacifica, 9% Asian, 24% European, And in terms of the hospitalisation, I believe that 22 of our hospitalisations are Māori. And I don't think any in ICU, but I'm not, I'll have to confirm that.
So how concerned are you about COVID cases in Taranaki given that wastewater result?
Well, we've had a wastewater result in Taranaki before, actually, in I think about June or July, which didn't turn into any cases. We don't have any evidence of any cases there. There is reasonable levels of testing, and we haven't seen any. So wastewater results are a useful indicator for us, but what, as Dr. McElnay has said, what that now means is we do want more people to be tested. We've stood up more community testing sites. One thing I would note is that there are people travelling through Taranaki. There's been a number of events in the area in Stratford that people, where the wastewater results been, where people have come from elsewhere in New Zealand. So there's a number of potential explanations. We have to manage these situations often, and the best thing we can do is get as many people tested, and we'll obviously be focusing on that in the next day or so.
Just further to Barry's questions, I mean, in terms of managing risk, we have people with COVID, 700 of them in the community, and then we've got people very unlikely to have COVID in managed isolation. Surely if overseas travellers who are going to be in Auckland can isolate only if they're in Auckland, and people who want to travel elsewhere could go into MIQ, why would that be so difficult to use that sort of system?
Well, I mean, there are significant logistical issues in terms of the way in which people arrive in New Zealand. It is not easy to immediately identify exactly where somebody wants to go, and so building the systems around that would be significant and would take some time. We are moving more towards this. We've shortened the stay in MIQ, and we will continue to carefully manage it. At the moment, we can manage people coming in through MIQ. It's a system that's booked, it's understood, we're making changes to it. But this is all about accumulation of risk, and if we've got any risk that we can manage or limit, then that's what we should do.
I don't think I've anything to add to that.
Sorry,
Mark, we haven't had Mark yet.
Barry, we'll just share it out,
and then we come back.
Following on from that question.
No, I'm actually going to take Mark, and then I'll come back.
This is a press conference.
Yep, I know, I'm answering questions, Barry. I'm going to go to Mark and then to you.
On climate change, Minister Shaw has said recently that he pushed Cabinet for a more ambitious NDC or Paris target, but Cabinet wouldn't sign off on that. Why was that?
Oh, well, I don't tend to comment on the internal discussions of Cabinet. I think everybody knows that the government is ambitious for our goals, and Minister Shaw wants us to go as far as we possibly can. When it came to the NDC, we had to look at what our options were for realistically being able to meet that, and making sure that as much as possible we're meeting that via the actions we take here in New Zealand. And obviously, it's clear to everybody, there'll be a component of what we now need to do that involves us having to buy credits offshore. We needed to make sure that we had a good balance of what we knew we could achieve, what we could, as much as possible, that we could do in New Zealand, and then supplement that with credits offshore.
On the hospitals in Auckland, yesterday on social media, someone who works at North Shore Hospital was saying that there are now patients being treated in the hallways due to a lack of rooms within proper hospital rooms. Is that something that you've heard?
No, that's not something that I'm aware of. And we've had meetings earlier today with the DHBs in Auckland, and they have assured us that the health system in Auckland is very able to cope with the hospitalisations that they're seeing at the moment.
Yeah, we ask that question every single day as to whether or not the system is coping with where hospitalisations are, where things are with ICU. We had that exact conversation this morning, and the system has been set up in order to be able to adapt to these forecast increases, and we knew that there would be more hospitalisations as cases increased, and the system is coping, and the senior medical staff that we spoke to today said they were comfortable with that, and noted, of course, that the number in ICU remains very, very low, which is obviously where people were concerned that the pressure point would arise.
Change in this listing locations of interest in Auckland, do you still have an expectation that exposure notifications through the app will be sent out for people who have scanned into, for example, a supermarket, or is that being put to an end as well?
Well, I think the situation in Auckland, because of the number of cases and also because of the restrictions that are in place in Auckland, some of those locations of interest are no longer applicable. But also what we've done is we've done our own local analysis as well as looked at the analysis that's been done elsewhere around what actually is the risk of people being infected in these in certain locations of interest, like supermarkets, and that's shown that it's very, very low risk there, that with the restrictions that we've got in place around distancing and masking, there's very small number of secondary cases as a result of that. So in Auckland, it makes sense because of the volume of cases and the volume of locations of interest that there's always a danger that the people that we're really trying to reach, those are the people in close contact situations, that the message gets lost in the detail. So we've decided to focus much more in Auckland. But of course, outside of Auckland, where there are no or very small number of cases, then it's still really relevant to post those locations of interest, even if there is a small risk, because we want people to come forward and get tested.
We'll go to Ben.
Just as a follow-up to the question that I was trying to ask, you said that you had to build systems around wanting to know where people wanted to go. How difficult is it? Now, what are the systems?
Yeah, well, people come from a vast array of places when they're returning to New Zealand. And they have a number of different places they want to come to. We don't necessarily know that as a government before someone gets on a plane. Yes, of course, a system could be built for that, but as we've... Well, because we don't have one at the moment.
Well, if people say they're simply going somewhere, they're from Auckland, surely you don't need a system to tell you that.
Well, again, if we just take a step back, the situation we've got here is we're trying to manage an overall risk of outbreak. Where we've got something where we have an immediate lever, which is that we can manage people coming in, when we think about accumulated risk, MIQ still serves that purpose for us. We are moving to a system where there will be more people in self-isolation, but while we're dealing with the outbreak we're dealing with, we have to look at all of the risks we have, and MIQ gives us the ability to manage that, but over time we will move away from it.
Can you just clarify, for this case who went home, they were advised not to go home, but they chose to go home. Is it in the hospital's power to stop them going home, or is that something you legally can't do? And if it is in your power, was there any discussion about doing that?
I don't know the details of the nature of the discussion that would have been held between this individual and the clinicians looking after that person. Unless there are particular reasons to restrict or retain people in hospital, then people have the right to refuse health services, health treatment. That's no different from anything else.
For reasons like particular infectivities, or public health reason rather than a kind of individual reason.
That can be a situation where if someone is perceived to pose a public health risk, then they could be required to stay at the hospital, or if it was felt that their judgment was affected in some way and that they weren't therefore making a well-informed, rational decision for a variety of reasons, then that's another situation where clinicians, again, through legal frameworks, could require that person to stay in hospital. But I don't know the details of this individual.
Given they just left hospital, had they had time to be given an oximeter?
I don't know the answer to that question, Benedict. I don't know the answer, but I do know that contact was made with them both on Wednesday and on Thursday.
And do you know how long it's taking you to get oximeters out to people in the community once they do test positive?
I don't have the details of the number, but I know that everybody gets one. I don't know the answer to that, but everybody does get one.
Should there be an expected time?
Yeah, and we'll get those details for you, because that's part of pulling this whole program together. They certainly all get contacted within 2 hours, I think, of the notification coming through, and then that's when all the package of care will be put together. But yes, the oximeters are provided to everyone, so my expectation is that they would get that.
Henry, in terms of the legal aspect of that, what's the difference between, say, if you have to do a medical assessment for someone to be able to isolate at home? This person has left the hospital, they were in hospital, I presume, for COVID. Shouldn't they then be transferred to, say, a managed isolation facility so that they're...
I do not know. Yeah. Again, it's just too early for me to know the clinical details in this situation.
Yeah, if someone discharges themselves from hospital, which, as we've just been discussing, they have the ability to do, in terms of what the steps that then happen next, obviously following up and being in contact with them, part of that assessment potentially could be, well, yes, we'd like you to go somewhere else, but clearly given the timeframes that we're talking about here, that would have been part of the process that was already underway. I said Jenna and then Bernard.
Yeah,
half of sport and then another one.
That's three, isn't it?
Sorry. For the sake of our Commonwealth Games athletes desperate to train, will you rethink the decision to let pools open at stage two as you'd originally planned?
So that was done on the advice of public health officials that around pools, and obviously the specific reasoning is around the use of masks and the difficulty that is associated with the use of masks in certain facilities. We will take the advice of public health on that, so there's no plan to revisit that because they only just gave us that advice.
They can open safely under a controlled booking system. They only let so many people in at a time. Why can't you let that happen specifically for our elite athletes?
Again, I'd defer to the public health advice that we got on that.
Consider, Dr.
McElnay? We're happy to consider everything at all times, and we do look at these situations very specifically and then provide our assessment of what the risk is, so we're happy to look at that.
Your new COVID ad says, in a quote, two shots to do the deed. Is the government now mandating you need a vaccination for intimacy?
you won't be surprised to learn that I don't write the copy for the advertisements, so... I'm not sure what would have been being referred to there, Gina. Dr. McElnay?
I cannot comment. I do not write the ads either.
But I'm sure if people need all manner of different incentives in order to be vaccinated, whatever it takes.
Minister, could you give us an update on where we are with mandates in terms of other industries that could be mandated, and also police in particular, given the idea that vaccinated police officers may be deciding when vaccinated people leave. And secondly, what the progress is on further income support for people on low incomes. There was some discussion a couple of weeks ago that Cabinet was going to consider it. I'm just wondering where that is.
Yeah, on the latter point, papers will go into Cabinet over the next couple of weeks in that regard. On the former point, those discussions are underway. We're looking at a number of, you know, the police is the obvious workforce, but there are other industries who've approached us. Bear in mind that the announcement we made was to create in law the risk assessment framework, which then allows employers to be able to see their business and how it works and adopt that risk assessment process. That still is probably the best way to do it, but there are some specific workforces, such as the police. What I'll do is get Minister Wood, who's leading that, to update you, Bernard. We'll just take a couple more. We'll come down the front here.
The first death this week, were they living in emergency housing?
I don't have the details of that.
My understanding was that they were living in a apartment block that has a mixture of housing types in it. That it has some people who are in transitional housing and some people who are renting and occupying that way. I don't have information as to which category this person fell into. Well, that investigation's underway.
The investigation is underway, and when we've got the details of that, we'll be able to share.
Would it be your expectation that people wouldn't be allowed to self-isolate if they were possibly in a more vulnerable housing situation? Like, surely that wouldn't meet the threshold for being safe to isolate at home?
I think that's where there's always going to be individual situations, but that's certainly the ability to self-isolate. Is a key factor in any assessment of where is a suitable place for someone to be, as well as who else is isolating with them, the nature of the housing. That doesn't necessarily mean that there are certain situations that you would say are completely off the table, because it all depends on the situation and also in terms of the any other factors that need to be taken into account, such as the individual and their other health needs, their support mechanisms, and what welfare package you can put in place.
We're just going to, just conscious of the time, we'll go here, Janae, Lillian, and then finish with Māori TV.
This morning the Herald reported on a crewman from Myanmar who jumped off the cargo ship near Gisborne.
Sorry, can you just say the beginning of that again? I missed it.
A crewman from Myanmar jumped off a cargo ship near Gisborne. 24 hours in freezing water, nearly died, and this person was seeking asylum. I'll give any comments on that situation, and also just the broader refugee resettlement program in New Zealand, given the disruptions of the country.
I don't have any information at all about the specific incidents. I just can't comment on that. More broadly, refugee resettlement has recommenced after a period of time during COVID when we weren't able to do that. In addition, we've obviously had the significant number of people come from Afghanistan, which has been a focus of the resources of our teams who look after those who are resettling. Asylum seeking is part of, you know, everyday life. It happens on a regular basis, clearly a lot less regularly when we haven't had flights and so on coming in, but I just don't have information about that case. Janae.
Thanks. Two questions. Do we have any data on how many new COVID cases got COVID because they're from someone who's isolating at home, like a household contact of someone isolating at home?
Well, quite a number of them will, because we know that households are the most likely source of transmission. I think your question is probably a bit more specific than that, but when we've looked at all the numbers that we've had in this recent outbreak, it certainly confirms that household transmission is the highest risk for transmission from a case to other contacts, which is one of the reasons that we look at the best way that we can provide self-isolation for that case away from their household members. In some situations, that's not possible, and not possible for a number of reasons. And so in that situation, then we have to manage the household as an entirety, and you would expect, given what we know from the research, that you would get other cases in those households.
So do we know the portion that is, you said a large portion, or would be household contacts? Do we know exactly?
It's about 60%. Where, I can get the precise figure, but it's about 60% are household secondary contacts, secondary cases through household transmission, about 60%. Yeah.
Lillian.
And just,
Janae, yep, I'll let you finish.
Thank you. On income support for low-income people, obviously you're not going to announce now what is being thought of, but could you give us a sense of the magnitude of that support? Is it slight changes to the welfare system, or is it going to be something quite significant?
Again, we're working through the options on that. Obviously, more broadly, we've increased benefits. We continue to make more emergency support available, but I'm working with Minister Cipollone on those issues right now. Lillian.
The Aged Care Association has come up calling for priority access to booster shots and rapid antigen testing for their residents and staff. Can you give any indication whether they might be successful?
Although the program around booster shots is obviously still being developed, what we have done is for those with amino issues, which is not really a booster shot, it's a third shot essentially to support somebody. That work's already underway, and the program around booster shots has been developed, so obviously we'll take into account the views of those who support our elderly. Clearly, they were some of the first people that we did vaccinate in terms of the regime that we had around making sure that the most vulnerable went first, and so we'll look at that for boosters as well.
Mm-hmm. No, that's right.
Just quickly, do you have the number of people who are community cases who are in MIQ in front of you?
Not right here,
not
but we'll
here.
Get that for
yeah.
you.
One more clarification for you. On the case who died this week, had they been in hospital for a very long time?
So is this the first one or the second one?
Has they been in hospital for quite a period? Is this a case of someone where they were basically in hospital for many weeks?
No, as I said earlier on, they were admitted on the 1st of November. That's the information that I've got. Yep. Is that another word for a question?
When it comes to that Auckland border, if you're going to let double vaccinated people cross it out,
yeah.
Do you need to be double vaccinated to go in?
Yeah, and that was a question that actually we talked about again on the 22nd of October, and we're working our way through that. If you think about it another way, that person then would have to leave, and then if they were leaving, then they would be double vaccinated. But it's actually one of the issues that we are discussing as to how the boundary would work if it was still in place.
Okay. Could you get your second jab inside Auckland?
I was going to say, one of the issues we're working through. I said Māori TV, Bernard, I'll take you and then Māori TV and we'll finish.
A question for both of you actually, but what is the capacity of the hospital system and the ICU system? Because we're at 69 in hospital in Auckland and we've got a few people in ICUs. What is the number that where it becomes difficult? You have to start cancelling elective surgeries and other tests and things. Is it 100, 200? Do we
I was just looking to see if I had some helpful data on that. We certainly, that the DHBs have all been asked to develop their plans and come up with those numbers, and I did have some information about the Auckland DHBs. What we have been assured at the moment is because of the ICU numbers are really very low in Auckland, that that is well within capacity. Mm. And that is something that certainly all the DHBs are very mindful of. It's not, of course, it's not just the ventilators that they have, but also the staff to manage that. So the ministry is collating that information to make sure that we've actually got the capacity to manage a surge in cases if that's required.
And in terms of broader hospitalisations, as I said at the start, we ask that question every day. We're assured that these are within both the expected range and what they can deal with. Each DHB has its plans to ensure that they have rooms, and so there have been changes made. We've discussed them here before, actually, where different wards have been reconfigured in order to be COVID wards and so on. And so from the perspective that we get on a daily basis, this is a manageable situation, both hospitalisations. ICU particularly, though, at 6 is a very small number, which is great, and definitely manageable. I said I'd finish with Marty.
You don't yet know what the surge capacity is for the hospitals.
We do, we just don't have that information here. Yeah, that's the point.
Looking forward to the possible alert level change in Northland. Is there enough testing in the area to give assurance that there isn't widespread community transmission? And if there isn't, what's the number that Cabinet will be comfortable with to say, hey, Northland, you can go back to normal?
So that'll be based on a public health risk assessment that Dr. McElnay and her team will give to the Director General and then come through to us. The more testing we can get, the better. We've seen really good testing rates in Northland over the last week or so, and we really encourage people over the weekend to continue to get tested, because it's that most up-to-date data that Dr. McElnay will advise
That's
us
right.
on.
We'll be doing that assessment on Sunday morning.
What's a good number for you, Doctor?
Today they were Northland authorities reported over 1,000 tests and had been taken yesterday. That is a good number. I'd like to see that sustained. It's not just the number, it's making sure that we're testing in the right places. And I know from what we've been told by the Northland authorities that they've got a number of places that they're setting up. There's also other information that we look at, such as wastewater testing, because that helps give us a signal as to something else that's happening in the community. So we'll put together everything that we know in terms of the test results, wastewater results, and also the follow-up on the cases and their contacts. The additional cases in Northland were from known contacts, and they are being managed. So we put all that information together and then provide that advice through to the DG.
All right, everybody. Thanks very much.